Hello, I'm Karina Lesser, Artistic Director of Scripps Presents, the public programming series at Scripps College in Claremont, California. And I'm delighted to welcome you to a conversation with Stanley Tucci about his wonderful new memoir. Scripps Presents seeks to complement the dynamic humanities curriculum at the college by bringing the most thoughtful and timely writers, artists, and scholars into conversation with our community. Our series is also an opportunity to partner with fantastic organizations like the Smithsonian Associates, who are as committed as we are to creating a forum for dialogue and reflection on the most critical issues of our times. You'll be hearing more about their offerings from program curator Lauren Rosenberg at the conclusion of this program. Tonight, we're so very pleased to be hosting two forces who have redefined how we cook and eat. Stanley Tucci is an actor, writer, director, and producer. He has directed 5 films and appeared in over 70, countless television shows, and dozens of plays on and off Broadway. He's been nominated for an Academy Award, a Tony, and a Spoken Word Grammy. He is winner of 2 Golden Globes and 2 Emmys, including one most recently for his delightful and informative Searching for Italy CNN series. He's here to discuss his new memoir, Taste, My Life in Food. Joining him is Ina Garten, the New York Times bestselling author of 12 cookbooks and the James Beard award-winning host of Barefoot Contessa, which has won 4 Emmy Awards and airs on the Food Network. She lives in East Hampton, New York with her husband, Jeffrey. Stanley, Ina, welcome to the Scripps Presents Smithsonian Associates virtual stage. We're so honored to have you.
Hi, everybody. I'm so excited to be here with you, Stanley. This is really fun. I woke up this morning and thought, I get to talk to Stanley Tucci today. How bad can the day be?
Well, I'm excited too, and I'm really glad you're doing this. Thank you so much. And I told you when we met just, you know, a few minutes ago at the beginning of this, that I was doing the crossword puzzle today and you were in it. And I thought that was a really good sign.
It's a good sign for everybody, for you and me. It was really exciting. So your memoir, Taste, My Life Through Food, which is a fabulous story of Stanley's life, but told through the lens of food and from childhood until now. And we're talking about a lot of food. It's just amazing. So it's such a charming book. I absolutely love it. And of course it has a dramatic ending, a little too dramatic, but every good book has a dramatic ending. And I think it should come with a warning sticker, which says, if you read this book, you will be very, very hungry because it's so appealing. And the other thing is, you will be Googling where to buy yourself a gas-fired paella pan for your patio, which I have to say I was. You make everything so appealing. You just want to go out and make it immediately, including the equipment. It's kind of a mashup between a charming memoir and Nigel Slater's Food Diaries, which is just wonderful. I love your stories and I love the recipes that go along with it. Did you always intend to do the stories with the recipes or did it just happen organically?
Well, I don't know. I had always written about, I mean, we had written, my wife and I had done a cookbook about 7 years ago and I had put together a cookbook with my parents many years ago. But I'd always written about food, but really just for myself, just to make notes about things. And I thought someday I might put together a sort of a compilation of anecdotes about food with recipies. But then when I had talked to Simon & Schuster, who they had approached me to do something, they said, you know, suppose you wrote a memoir. And I thought, oh God, I wish my life were more interesting in order to write a memoir. But you know, they said, but in essence, you'd be telling the story of your life through food. And I thought, okay, well, let's try that. So I tried it and now it's over.
And can I say they were right? Because the stories are wonderful. I know it's scary approaching doing a memoir because everybody thinks their life isn't interesting enough to be kind of laid out there. But the way you tell it, it's just so charming and so fun. And it's just great to read all the stories and then have a recipe that is important to you, which is interesting. Because I find your recipes are like the way I love things. They're simple. They're taking the intrinsic ingredients and making them taste better. They're classic, they're simple, but they're right. They're not tricked up in any way. Like, as you say, fettuccine Alfredo with turkey. How do you feel about that? Ooh, bad idea.
Don't get it.
I think you have a few special words in the book about it.
Yes, I do, yeah.
So what's your philosophy about recipes? What are you looking for?
Well, exactly what you just expressed, which is also why your books work so well to me.
It's important to me too. Yeah.
Yeah, they're very clear. They make you feel like you can do it, even if you're not somebody who's an experienced cook. They make it possible, and I think that's one of the exciting things about reaching out to people about cooking, which is we can do this, you can do this, and mm-hmm. we should do this, because it's a really wonderful expression of love. It's a wonderful activity to do with your family, with your kids, but even just for yourself. It's this incredible sense of accomplishment that occurs, you know, when you have successfully made a meal, almost no matter how simple that meal is. It's just a wonderful feeling.
And I think you do it for the same reason I do. The food is important, but also it's the connection that you get yeah. with people that you share it with. It's yeah. about taking care of them. It's about loving them. And it's about getting everybody around the table. And I think yeah. that started when you were a kid growing up in Katona, New York, which is in Westchester, which is yeah. not far from where I grew up. I grew up right over the border in Connecticut, a few miles from there, amazingly. Oh, I did. Yeah. So I know exactly what your life was like
you,
there.
You know then, yeah. yeah.
Exactly. So you grew up with your mother, who was a fabulous cook. Was your father also a cook?
No, my father was sort of the sort of sous chef, and his father cooked.
That's right.
Because yeah. his wife had died when I was quite young, so he really, but he always cooked, I think, anyway. But my dad was a sous chef. He would cook though on a Friday night.
Yeah, one day a week. Yeah.
Yeah, I would put some of those recipes in the book. They were very straightforward, simple stuff. But delicious, and of course he barbecued and all that. But the cooking really fell to my mother, who, as I said in the book, you know, she says that she couldn't even boil water when she met my father. But I have difficulty believing that.
And so she cooked mostly Italian food when you were growing up, but then yeah. at some point discovered Julia Child, which is so yeah. interesting that you got to play Paul Child in Julia. How crazy is that?
It was so. It was weird. I mean, I remember we were at this Christmas party at my friend Natasha Richardson, who passed away.
Oh, how wonderful.
She was a great cook, Natasha. She was an amazing cook.
I'd heard that.
And I was at the party and Meryl was there. And obviously I knew Meryl a bit. And she said, "Do you want to play my husband in this movie about Julia Child?" What do you
and
say?
You hesitated. You thought yeah. about it. I'll get yeah. back to you tomorrow.
Call my agent, you know. So I couldn't believe it, because I love Julia Child, and I do write a whole bit about my yeah. mom, you know, loving Julia Child and all that, but also how when I got older too, Julia Child became equally important to me, and then the movie came along, so it was just sort of kismet, I guess.
It really is. It's really wonderful. So when you were growing up, what did your mother used to cook? And did you cook with her, or you just kind of were around the kitchen and saw what she was doing?
I was around the kitchen, and she would show me periodically what to do. Or you were asked to help, so you would help. And the same with my grandmother, her mother. You know, they were both always cooking. Even my mom had a full-time job. She'd come home and cook these amazing meals, and on the weekend wow. she was cooking, and they were having dinner parties. And I remember their dinner parties being, you know, these really sort of lovely. This is, you know, 1960s, 1970s, when everybody still sort of dressed nicely, and and you had,
as opposed to leggings, the way I dress now.
No, I wasn't talking about you.
The bottoms.
But I remember people showing up in jackets and, you know, ties and all that sort of, yeah. you know, and for a. Just a simple dinner party, like maybe six people or something like that. But they were always, my mother had set the table always so beautifully, and in advance, like 3 days in advance too. And then she'd cook, and she would make, and people loved coming to the house because her meals were incredible, really incredible.
And that's why people came. I always find if you call and say, "I love you, come for dinner," everybody shows up.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, of course.
And it's just that simple.
Yeah. I mean, my wife and I said the other day, we were like, you know, nobody invites us to dinner. And they say, "Well, let's meet at a restaurant," but they'll never invite us over to them. We think, are they intimidated? They shouldn't be intimidated. But this couple recently just invited us out, and we had the most wonderful time. And we told them, we said, "You're the first people to invite us to dinner in like years."
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I also, because of the because of COVID, nobody's inviting anybody.
No.
But then you don't want to go to a restaurant. You'd rather go to somebody's house.
Yeah, I know. Exactly.
But it's true. Very few people invite us for dinner.
I can only imagine. I wouldn't invite you to dinner.
Okay. You can invite me to dinner. The truth is, I don't care what you make. We'll just have a good time. It really doesn't matter. Make it for top.
That'll make it for top.
Right. So once your mother found Julia Child, how did her cooking change? Was she doing things in Le Creuset pots with coq au vin and things like that? Or was it all kind of mixed up?
That was a bit mixed up. She would make the wonderful sort of crepes with with chicken and bechamel, and that we just loved, you know. And she'd do escargot. Remember, you can buy they come in that thing, right? So it's the shell.
The thing with the shells, exactly.
Yeah, and then she'd buy the snails and then put them in the shell and then make them like that, just with the garlic butter. But God, we loved it. And she'd make paella, and her paella was absolutely, absolutely delicious. And she'd make it with seafood and chicken. She'd put lobster in it. Oh my God, it was amazing. Amazing.
You know, when you go to the markets in France, and there's always somebody in the market making paella like that on a gas fire paella pan. It's a huge thing. And you're just like, it's so delicious. You want to run right home and make it.
No,
it's
I know.
Extraordinary. I know.
There's a guy who makes it here where I live at the farmer's market.
Seriously?
Right around the corner here on a Saturday. And he always has a pan of it going.
Isn't that great?
That's great.
So when you were 13, everything changed. Your father decided he wanted to do he was a sculptor, and he moved to Italy to study in Italy, in Rome. Right? And the entire family moved to Rome.
We moved to Florence.
To Florence. Yeah. Oh, I'm sorry.
So we arrived in Rome. We were in Rome for a couple of days, and then we ended up living in Florence for the school year, because he was teaching sculpting and painting and all that sort of stuff in Westchester at the high school, and he decided to take a sabbatical and study at the Accademia in Florence, studies bronze casting and all that. And it was amazing for us. It was shocking.
Did you think it was exciting going into it, or did you realize what an incredible experience it was when you were there?
I was excited going into it, but we were also fearful. We had never been we'd been to Vermont.
That's not Florence.
I think that was about as far, and to New York City. I'd never been anywhere else. probably drove by your house in Connecticut for all.
Yeah,
I know.
Probably exactly.
But I didn't. We didn't go anywhere. So to get on a plane, number one, was huge. So this is 1972, 73. Getting on a plane and then living in a city as opposed to the suburbs. And our suburbs were quite rural, really, at that stage. It was scary, but it was absolutely thrilling. In the end, it was thrilling.
And you had your first restaurant experience there. Was that in Rome?
Yes. Yeah, in Rome. I'd never been to a restaurant. I mean, went to a place in Somers called the Muscoot. It was a pizza joint that had been an old tavern. It had been around since like the turn of the century or something like that, 1920s. That was the only restaurant I'd ever been in. And the sort of classic Italian restaurant, brightly lit, white tablecloths, waiters in white jackets, nothing fancy by any means. But it was, I'd never seen anything like it. And I was just thrilled. And I had no idea what I ate, but it didn't matter because the environment was so new and so exciting. I'll never forget the image of it. And how kind the waiter was, and how when we went back, I don't know, 6 months later or something, or a few months later, the guy remembered.
Really?
He remembered my sister's names.
Wow.
But this is so classic sort of Italian waiter behavior. They have these memories that are astounding.
I also think that at this point at 13, you had no idea what you were going to do when you grew up, but you liked the theater of it, didn't you? You liked the whole... how it all evolved and how it happened and how it came out of the kitchen and how the waiters dealt with everything. There was something about it that felt to me like it was theater.
Yeah, and I always, and in the book, I sort of compare a restaurant to the theater. In essence, you have the backstage,
that's
the kitchen, right, offstage.
Yeah.
And then you have on stage, which is the dining room.
Yeah.
And you know, the behavior in the kitchen is completely different than the in the dining room, just like it is backstage. If you've ever been backstage during a performance, you see people running around like crazy, or maybe getting angry at each other, or laughing, or doing whatever.
Throwing things.
You know, trying to, what?
Throwing things.
Throwing things and going like this. And then you walk on stage and, you know, boom, you're crying, you're laughing, you're doing whatever you have to do, with whatever is appropriate for the role.
I can't tell you how many.
Same as the waiter.
I can't tell you how many times I've compared catering to noises off. How does it go? I think you see the play first.
Yes.
It's a play within a play. Then you see backstage and you see what total chaos is going on. And then you see the play a second time and you realize that the guy who just ran in was pushed in because you know what's going on backstage now.
That's right.
Isn't that the way Noises Off works?
Yeah. I think that's it.
And I think restaurants are the same thing.
Yeah. It's one of the most brilliant plays ever.
Brilliant.
Ever.
And it's not played. It's not played very much. Have you seen it?
I have seen it. I remember seeing it, the original company in New York in the 1980s, maybe.
Yeah.
And then I saw it again later in a quite a good production that actually Tom McCarthy was in. The director Tom McCarthy, who did Spotlight, was in. And it was done. It was done again. I don't know, sometime here, I think, but I didn't see it.
Good, because I think it's one of the great plays.
But it is that sort of schizophrenic behavior that takes place in the theater and in a restaurant or catering. It's the way it is.
It's the way it is. There are probably a lot of situations like that. So you're not just a great actor, but you're also a trained cook. You've worked in lots of restaurants. So the first one was... Well, the first one was Alfredo. Alfredo's
oh
the original.
Oh my God! Well, yes, but not as a cook. I first worked as a busboy.
Yeah.
And I was a terrible busboy. And so then,
you were terrible, so they promoted you to the barista, right?
Yeah, I was a bar boy. I became a bar boy.
A bar boy.
Meaning, I was the assistant to the bartender.
Yeah.
Who then trained me to be a bartender.
Isn't
and when
great?
I became a bartender, it was a great feeling. I loved it. And I used to know how to make every drink under the sun. Now, of course, I can't remember. But it was a great experience. But also, again, that is the experience that led me to understand the disparity between the kitchen and the dining room. But also just how and how a restaurant functions and also doesn't function.
And doesn't, yeah, exactly. That's where it falls apart as well. But then you went on to, did you work in the kitchens like at La Madre? I love
yeah,
La Madre.
What I did was La Madre was a great restaurant. And I'm so sad that it disappeared because it was a really, really wonderful restaurant.
Yeah, really great.
I did Johnny Scapine, who was the chef there, the head chef there, and eventually oversaw all of Pino Longo's restaurants. He was kind enough to sort of take me under his wing and train me to a certain extent. He taught me how to cut certain things, chop certain things, how to make a frittata, how to make a risotto, how to toss up a pan of spaghetti, how to do all that sort of stuff. And I would pop in when I wasn't filming something to learn from him as I was trying to raise money for Big Night, the movie that we were trying to get made at the time.
Which is so wonderful. I love Big Night. Everybody loves Big Night. For anybody that doesn't know, it's Stanley's wonderful movie. You wrote and directed and acted in it, right?
Yeah, I wrote it with my cousin, Joe Tropiano, and Campbell Scott and I co-directed it. And we never expected, it was this tiny movie. We never expected it to do anything. And
it's a classic. It's a total classic. And it's so wonderful. And I love that you decided to make a movie that was sort of European, where the end kind of just, you know, there's no happy ending. It's just kind of drifts off the way European movies do. So what were the things that you were looking for that were different from a classic American movie, like a Hollywood movie?
Yeah, well, the idea was that the story be sort of character driven, as opposed to the plot.
Which is very European.
Yeah, very European. And the plot is incredibly simple in Big Night. Also that when the brothers spoke to each other, that for the most part, they spoke in their native language. Which you don't often see. People are always just speaking in accents, but sort of for no reason. It's like, well, they're talking to each other. Why don't they just speak in Italian? There's nobody else in the room. It doesn't make any
Interesting,
sense.
Interesting, yeah, you're right.
Yeah. But also that the Italian immigrant have no connection to the mafia. And that was something that was very rarely done. I think there were only 8 films out of 100 and I don't know how many that did not have a connection to the mafia. And when it came to the Italian character in the film. So that was really important for Joe and I had played mafiosi, and at that point I had sort of stopped playing them because I didn't want to do it anymore. And, you know, you're getting typecast, but also you felt like you needed to do something in the cinema to change that unfortunate stereotype. And Big Night helped do that. And I'm glad about that. Things are different now, which is good. But also that it have this sort of ambiguous ending and that we, you know, we're never quite sure how it ends. It's not a happy, happy ending. It's not a sad ending. It's just,
it just drifts off like life. In your mind, what happens? Do they get saved or you don't know? It doesn't matter.
I don't know. And, you know, people always ask that, but I always imagine that maybe that the older brother, Primo, goes home. And Secondo tries to stick it out for a while and then goes home too.
Which is what anybody would want to do because everybody wants to live in Italy.
Right, yeah. I mean, why not? Yeah. Or maybe, who knows? Maybe they ended up in London like me. Who knows?
And I love that you brought all your friends together. I have a feeling they not only wanted to act with you, but they also wanted to have staff lunch with you.
Yes,
did you
right.
Did you end up cooking for everybody?
No, here's the thing. I was just talking to somebody about this the other day. I wish I could cook. There was no time. I mean, there was literally
no time.
Yeah. I was acting and directing, forget it. We had someone make the food, right? You have to have a food stylist and somebody cook all the food.
Yeah.
All that stuff.
Right.
So, but then the catering we had just for us to eat was terrible. So I felt so badly that the people, and I hope the caterer isn't watching this 20 some years ago, but it wasn't good. We didn't have any money for that, for good food. So when you worked on Nora's movies, you had good food. Like we had great catering on Nora's.
Yeah, Nora really cared about food.
Yeah, on my film, it was just terrible. It was terrible. but the budget was, you know, like $4 million or something. So yeah.
For the whole movie, including the food.
Movie. Yeah, for the whole movie.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
So this is a very typical thing that you tell the story of Big Night and then also tell the recipe of how to make is it timpani? Am I pronouncing
timpano.
It right?
Timpano.
Timpano. Timpano. Yeah. Can you describe for the audience what a timpano is? and just remember, this is the first course in an Italian meal, which is unbelievable.
It's unbelievable. So you basically take like a Le Creuset, you know, casserole thing. Is that what you'd call it? Yeah, you know.
Yeah, Le Creuset. Yeah.
Yeah. Or you can do it in an enamel basin, which is what they used to make it in. My family used to make it in. So you make this sort of this dough that's sort of like a pasta pizza like dough combination. And then inside this timpano, meaning drum, timpano. Right, for like timpani drum.
Like timpani.
Yeah, you're filling it with tzatziki or penne, something like that. You're filling it with a meat-based ragu, not a ground beef ragu, but a meat-based ragu. You're filling it with little meatballs. You're filling it with Genoa salami. You're filling it with provolone. You're filling it with egg yolks. And you're filling it with hard-boiled eggs. And you're filling it with pecorino romano. Then you're covering the whole thing up and you're baking it for about an hour, hour and a half. Then you let it sit, you flip it over, you take off the pot, hopefully, if it hasn't stuck.
Yeah.
And then you reveal what looks like a beautiful timpani drum. It's all golden. Then you let it cool for a while. Then you slice it like a pie.
And it's just, it's amazing. And it looks amazing in the film. But let's remember, it's the first course.
Yes, the first course. I mean, this is what we have at Christmas. And I write about it in the book that after that, what are you going to eat? How are you supposed to eat after that? It doesn't make any sense.
A green salad? I don't think so. There are many other courses after that.
Yeah. Like, oh, let's have a goose now.
it's just so wonderful. I love the, I mean, you can smell it when you're reading about it in the book, and you just want to go out and make it. I don't know that you want to eat it immediately, but you want to make it.
No, it is, and some people really hate it. Most people I know don't care for it. I personally love it. I made one recently with someone here in London, and luckily
it all
worked. Yes, because we were making it for a photo shoot thing, and it worked. Thank God it worked.
Because you never know when you turn it over whether it's going to.
No, you never know. It could just all fall apart.
After all that work, which brings me to ragu. I know it's called different things in different cultures, but I had one experience with what I think Italian Americans call Sunday gravy, and you may actually know the person who made it for us. So we were we invited a group of friends to join us at Blue Hill at Stone Barns, which you probably know in Westchester, near where you grew up in Katona. Yeah. And we were sitting there. We had a table in the kitchen. It was just fantastic. And we were served the most delicious, like a carrot steak that had been perfectly grilled a la plancha, absolutely delicious. And one of the guests was Nick Pileggi.
Oh, yes. Well, of course.
The filmmaker.
Nora's husband. Yeah.
Nora's husband. Of course. That's right. You know. And in the middle of this incredibly delicious, mostly vegetarian meal, he says, you know, I should invite all of you for Sunday gravy one of these days. And I didn't know what Sunday gravy was. So I thought, oh, that's the other extreme from these little perfectly grilled carrots.
Yeah.
So Nick actually invited us, and he described exactly what it was. And it was amazing. So can you explain what ragu or Sunday gravy is to everybody?
Okay, so ragu, see, Sunday gravy too is a word I never grew up with.
Right, exactly. It's not really Italian.
Yeah, that's a real sort of New York, Italian, American thing. So I never, but somebody said to me once, Sunday gravy, I was like, what are they talking about? They're talking about like gravy, like you put on turkey at Thanksgiving? so a ragu is any, I mean, ragu was brought by all accounts to Italy by the French. And a ragu is anything that's basically made that's a meat-based sauce. So a classic ragu would be taking something like pork ribs, and maybe like a shin of beef or something like that, and maybe even a pig's foot or something like that, throwing it in, searing it, putting in a little bit of onion, maybe some garlic, red wine, tomato paste, tomato, and maybe basil or, you know, something like that, oregano or something, a little bit, and olive oil. And you just cook that slowly. And you take out the meat. And the way Italians do it traditionally is that meat is then served on, the sauce is served on pasta, a dried pasta, like a good, strong, durable pasta. And then the meat is served as the second course. So that meat has broken down and gotten really sort of just melts in your mouth. So what you're doing is you're creating two courses with one dish.
Actually, Nick ended up putting in, he started adding things to it, like meatballs and sausage and other kinds of meats to it. So, I mean, it was absolutely delicious. It was the richest thing you ever ate in your life.
Like,
and you had to come and take a nap afterwards. Yeah. But it was so good.
Yeah, it's so good. When it's made well and cooked slowly and on, you know, and all those flavors are layered.
Yeah.
Like my parents make the meatballs in advance. They're fried. And then later they're put after the sauce is cooked for like 2 hours, then you put the meatballs in for the last half hour or something like that. And then they take on that sauce.
All the flavors of that. And actually, like you, as you did with the timpano, am I pronouncing it right?
Timpano.
As you did with the timpani, Nick put his Sunday gravy into his movie Goodfellas.
Yes, so that's right.
Each of you cooked something in your movies.
Oh, that's so funny. Yeah.
You love making.
That's the one where they're in prison and they're slicing. They slicing the garlic with the razor blades or something like that.
Exactly. It's all they had in prison or something. Yeah. No, what in prison? It was they were at the mattresses or something. I don't know what they were doing.
That is so funny, yeah.
It was really great. But it's great to see it in a movie particularly.
Yeah.
So you met your first wife in 1995 and sadly lost her to cancer in 2009. Must have been just devastating. But I gather you shared a love of a joy of food together. Did you used to cook together?
Yeah, we did used to cook together. And she ultimately became a much better cook than I did, because she was much more patient than I. There's a story in the book that I tell about, you know, my mom's this amazing cook, and she always made lasagna bolognese. And my mother's, you know, making everything from scratch, everything. So you'd have the spinach pasta and regular pasta, and then the bolognese, and then the bechamel, and everything is just sort of layered, and it takes forever to make it. So Kate learned how to make it, and she ended up making it so well one time that, and then from then on, that my mother tasted it. My mother said, "I have nothing left to teach you."
Oh, I love that story.
You know, like everyone started crying.
I'm crying.
And she wasn't saying it in an arrogant way, or she was just like, she was so happy that somebody had really taken the time to learn how to do this properly, and she knew that this was going to be passed down.
And also, she was making it for her son.
Yeah, exactly.
Wonderful, what, absolutely what wonderful.
Better? Yeah.
And it was just.
and she was from Wisconsin, you know.
That's great. So a year after you lost Kate, you were invited to a so-so wedding. It was your co-star in Devil Wears Prada at a kind of mediocre house in Lake Cuomo, yeah. Right? But you thought it was worth going to. And
I struggled, yes.
You struggled with that.
Yeah.
And your co-star, Emily Blunt, obviously did the seating for her own wedding to John Krasinski. And I don't think it was a coincidence that she seated you next to her sister. Am I right?
Yes, it was interesting. Yes, I think yes. I had met her sister at the premiere of The Devil Wears Prada. And Kate.
Oh, you'd met before. Yeah.
We had met just briefly. And Felicity and Kate got along very well. They talked about books, as they're both, you know, voracious readers. But then when I was at the wedding, I started to talk to Felicity, and, you know, she was so charming and she was so funny. And we talked about
beautiful.
Beautiful. And tall.
And tall.
Almost too tall, but it was fine. And she started talking about food, and we just never stopped talking about food. And I was, after that wedding, I was going straight to London to do a film, and I said, "Well, why don't let's have dinner?" So we had dinner, and then that was it. Then we started dating and eating a lot, and we still do.
I love the scene where you describe after you finished the meal at a restaurant, the cheese cart went by. She was like, "Can we have some of those?" And then the dessert cart goes by. I'm like, "We'll take that too." And you were like looking at her with astonishment. And yet she's this tall string bean, right?
I know. I really had never seen anything like it. I mean, it passed the point of being attractive to, I was almost.
It was probably really attractive.
It's sexy. I think that it's sexy when people love to eat.
When women enjoy things like that.
Yes. There's no like, "Oh, I'm worried about, oh God, just eat it."
Just eat and just get over it. Exactly. Yeah. I'm a proponent of that.
Yeah.
So you and I have something in common, which is an adoration for your, let's see, for Felicity and Emily's roast potatoes, which Felicity made for your family, right?
Yeah.
And Emily made for me on my show.
Oh, that's right.
And they are the best roast potatoes in the world. And you described how she was making them, and everybody was like, "Are you going to roast them? You're cooking them on the top of the stove." And then she heated up oil in the oven. It was like, "When are you going to roast these potatoes?"
Yeah.
But aren't they astonishingly good?
They're incredible. I mean, they really are incredible. When she started doing it, first she boiled them.
Yeah.
And I said, "What are you doing?" She was making roast potatoes. I was like, "All right, well, I didn't know you boiled roast potatoes. All right, that's fine." So she boils them and then she has heated up, you know, like this much layer, a layer of goose fat.
Oh, yeah,
You
that's right. She uses goose
use
fat.
oil, but you really want to use goose fat.
On a sheet pan in the oven.
Yeah, which
Yeah.
is extremely dangerous. And so she then takes the potatoes, and you know, because you saw
Yeah,
Emily do
you rough them up in
it,
the pan.
drain it, they do shake them up like this, so they get fluff, they get like
Rough
fluffy
edges
on the outside.
and
They
rough
get
edges. Yeah.
rough edges. And then they take it and they put them, place them gently into this searing hot, bubbling oil, put them into the pot.
Smoking hot,
It's
bubbling oil.
insane. It's like really, it's horrifying. And I thought she was going to burn the house down. And we were in this rented house. And I saw my mother like leave the room. You know, she panicked, you know. And the smoke, we were blood, the fire, where the fire alarm was going off. And it was just like, anyway. So then we taste these things. And as you know, they're incredible. I'd never tasted anything like it.
Anything
Absolutely.
really, because they're like,
Soft on the inside.
I describe them like fried potatoes on the outside and like mashed potatoes inside. They're
Yes.
just incredible, and
Yes.
they're good enough to be in your book, and I also put them in my book. So anybody that likes potatoes like that, get Stanley's book. It's worth it.
I'm telling you, it's so weird. Why did we never know about this in
I
America?
had no idea. Do you know if Felicity's mother invented it, or is it a classic English
No,
potato?
it's a classic English potato.
No.
It's classic. So every time you go, because all the pubs will have Sunday roasts, right? Which is something I
Ah.
really love in England. And sometimes they're good and sometimes they're not so good. But they always have roast potatoes. And so everybody makes it. It's a national tradition. But it was Felicity's grandmother, their mother, Joanna's mother, who taught them how to do it.
Well, I'm so glad that she did.
Yeah, me too. Me
It's
too.
really amazing. So then comes the shocker in the book, which is that you at some point had a dreadful battle with oral cancer, which thank God you've recovered from and it's in the past. But that must have been a dreadful, dreadful 2 years. And it's just, it did it. Did you always intend to include it in your book, or did you include it because it really heightened your appreciation for tasting things, which is what this book is about?
Yeah, I think there was no way I couldn't put it in the book because, and I, you know, say in the book, it's that I realized that everything, so many things that have influenced me throughout my life have come in through my mouth. And
We'll just leave it at
just leave it
that.
at that. Yeah, well, yeah. But so when you can't, when you can't eat, when you can't drink even water, you can't even drink water, you have to,
Was astonishing.
was so painful. When you can't taste, when anything, any food or anything just smells horrible. When you begin to try to taste things, you taste only the worst component of things. It's very odd. And it took, and is still, it's been 3 years now. And there's, you know, I have, there's no evidence of disease. And luckily, the cancer had not metastasized, which, had it metastasized, it's a different situation, as we know. It's a highly curable cancer, thank God. And but yes, I had to put it in the book because it made me realize how much I love eating, cooking, drinking, sharing food, and that my whole life is really about that. That it's more important to me now than just about anything else I do. And the fact that it was almost taken away from me, that it was taken away from me for a
Was,
while,
yeah.
almost taken away from me permanently, was a terrifying, terrifying thought. And it was in a very hard recovery. And this is a kind of cancer that is rampant now, unfortunately. So my hope is that, you know, people, if you feel anything that you think isn't right, just go get it checked.
Yeah. Don't brush it off. It's really serious.
No.
And I'm so glad you're well, and I'm so glad you can enjoy it. So when you're doing your show, Searching for Italy, and you're going around just tasting things, it seems to me it's just a celebration of what you regained that you had lost. Does it feel that way to you too?
Absolutely. I mean, I'm going back to do more.
Oh, good. Everybody's going to be pleased.
A month. Yeah. So it'll all be out next year. We're going to do like 6 more or something. I can't remember. With a few more this year and then more next year. But yes, it is a celebration. But when I started the show, I still was unable to eat a lot of stuff. I could taste everything, but I couldn't necessarily swallow. You lose your saliva.
Yeah.
And if you don't have the proper amount of saliva, it's very difficult. Even just to eat a piece of bread can take you 20 minutes. So eating a piece of meat is nearly impossible because the saliva, of course, helps break it down. And but yes, so it was a very difficult road, the first 4 episodes. But I was so determined to do it because it's something that I love so much. And I love Italy. And I really wanted to tell that story about the diversity of food in Italy and the diversity of Italy itself.
And it's been so, people love that show. Is it harder to play Stanley Tucci in Searching for Italy, or is it harder to play a character in a movie?
Oh no, it's much harder to be yourself.
A lot of people say that. I've never played anything other than myself, so I don't know. A lot of actors who have to memorize like pages and pages of lines say, how do you, it's so hard to play yourself. And I'm like, it's easier because I can just say whatever I want.
No,
but you actually do both, so you can say for sure which one's harder.
No, I think this for me. I mean, I so admire what you do. You do it so well and so effortlessly. And when I have tried to do it, excuse me, just cooking in front of a camera or something, I've always sort of I get so terribly nervous, and I'm better at it now. But when I first started doing it, I would panic, and then doing this show, I was really afraid, and I didn't know it was going to be as hard as it was. I thought, oh my God, why can't I just pretend I'm someone else? It's so much easier. You know, and even memorizing lines is easier. And I have to make things, I don't want to make it up, you know. But then once you settle into it, and again, the same rules apply as they do in acting, which is ask the question, listen to the response, and then respond accordingly. Mm-hmm. That's the same as acting. So once I settled into that,
That's actually really good advice.
Yeah. Then it was okay. Then I could sometimes watch myself. Other times I still can't watch myself.
Unfortunately, it's just me and a camera. So I can't, I can ask it a question, but it won't respond.
But you're so good at it. It's so impressive.
You know, every time I start a recipe, I say to my director, I'm never going to be able to memorize this entire recipe, but I'll just start and then we'll stop and I'll look at the recipe. And she says, you always remember it. And I'm like, I know I do, but this time I really can't. And then I'll just go through the whole recipe. I don't know where it comes from, but it's terrifying every time. And I've been doing it for 20 years. So I know that kind of terror, but you know what? It makes you show up. You really, you never phone it in because it's so terrifying.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. There is a mechanism in us that makes us be afraid, even when we know we don't have to, just so we
can step exactly. up to the plate. Yeah. So Stanley, we have a lot of audience questions. Can I ask you some of the audience questions?
Yeah.
Okay, I'll pick the good ones. How's that? So this is about Searching for Italy. Francine wanted to know, your CNN series was so spectacular. I hope for a second season. I think we just answered that.
Yes,
right?
We're doing it, yes.
If so, will you cover the historic marzipan makers of Erice in Sicily, perhaps the Trapani salt flats, Marsala wine production, and that's just Sicily. And I actually have been to those places in Sicily.
You have? No.
I have, yeah.
Yeah, no, we're not going to go back to Sicily because we did Sicily already.
We did.
So we focused on different stories in Sicily. We did do one confectionery store, a very old confectionery store that was, you know, it's all that marzipan. Amazing.
Yeah, exactly. Marzipan. Isn't that wonderful to watch?
It's incredible.
Oh my, it's just incredible. Is it the one that's associated with a convent on the hill?
No, oh, it's no, different. No. This was right in I think it was in either in Palermo or Catania. It was absolutely beautiful. But no, I'm afraid we won't be going back to Sicily, but I'll go myself and let them know.
Angela wants to know, which Italian dish brings you the greatest joy to eat or cook? That's pretty hard. That's a hard question.
That's really, really, it's almost impossible to say, but I'll tell you what I made last night.
Oh, what'd you make last night?
I made pasta con vongole, so spaghetti con vongole.
So wonderful.
And then I just shaved Bottarga on top of it, the dried fish, you know, gray mullet or roe, salted roe. Oh my God, it's just the one.
And the simplest ingredients, and it really brings out the flavor of the clams, which is just amazing. Yeah, that really is, I don't know why anybody goes to so much trouble to make things that are incredibly complicated when that's so delicious.
I know, you don't need much, no.
Yeah.
No.
Okay, for Stanley and I know you've gotten this question because I've gotten it a lot. If you could pick your last meal, what would it be and who would prepare it for you? I haven't gotten that part.
No, I never got that part. Well, it'd probably be my mother and my grandmother.
I know.
What it would be anything they want to make is fine with me.
That's excellent. I think mine would be Julia Child and coq au vin, because that was for me is the iconic Julia Child recipe, and it's the thing that I had in France that really got me started thinking the way she had sole meuniere.
Yeah,
that really got me started thinking about cooking French food.
Really,
and you actually got to on the movie set. You got to actually eat sole meuniere with Meryl Streep as Julia Child, and I love that scene. Where she's trying to decide what to do with her life.
Yeah.
And what did you say to her?
I said, she says something like, well, I like to eat. She said, yes, you're really good at it.
I love that. And you told me once that you would ad-lib that.
I did,
kept it in the movie. You said, you're very good at it. what's your absolutely favorite city to visit? This is from Mary Ellis.
Oh.
Do you have one favorite city?
No. I think I really do love, I really still do love Florence, because I think it's because where I spent time as a kid. So I still get a little sort of flutter in my heart.
Yeah. Isn't that wonderful that you can still get a flutter in your heart from going to a city like Florence?
When you go off sort of off season in the winter time, so, you know, it's nice. It's nice. What about you? Do you have one?
Well, it's definitely Paris. And I never arrive there without getting that flutter in my heart.
Yeah.
It's just so exciting. It really is. And everybody wants to know, how do you stay so fit making Italian cuisine?
Well, I exercise a lot.
Yeah, that's the answer.
Yeah. But honestly, I am blessed with a fast metabolism. So that's good. But I'm not a snacker. I don't snack. And I don't,
I think that's a big deal.
That definitely makes a big difference. And I don't eat, you know, I don't eat processed foods. I don't eat junk food. I don't eat any of that stuff. And I don't really eat sugar. I don't eat a lot of sweets. It just never sat well with me, but I do eat a lot of pasta.
And that's actually a trademark of Italian food. I mean, they would have like a fresh fig for dessert or some kind of fruit and a little cookie, and that's it.
They don't
fancy like chocolate mousse kind of desserts.
No, I mean, every now and again, if you're going to a fancier restaurant or something, they'll do that. But they'll have a little gelato, or they'll have, you know, a sorbet or something. They'll have a sweet, their breakfast, particularly the farther south you go, is always something sweet. They don't do like eggs and all that stuff like we do.
Like, what's an Italian sweet that you would have for breakfast? Like a little bambolini?
Yeah, that, or you'd have like a cornetto, which is the Italian croissant. But it always has like a sugar.
Oh yeah, I've had that.
Everything is always sweet. And the farther south you go, once you get into, excuse me, down in Naples and then in Sicily, my God, they're eating these huge sort of, they're eating like a brioche stuffed with ice cream or gelato or not gelato. Yes, yes. And
oh, that's painful. That's like painful. Okay, let's see. One more question.
All right.
What's one more question? Do you have a favorite restaurant for truffles? I actually have one that's in Milan. There's a restaurant called, I have to think of the name of it now, where I just remember it was like a dark street and you walk in, Paper Moon in Milan. And there was a really dark street. It was night. There was nobody around. There was like a cat walking down the street. And I remember opening the doors to the front door to Paper Moon, and it was white truffle season. And this waft of white truffles just hit you like a wall. And everything that they were doing had shaved white truffles on it. It's a moment I'll never forget.
Yeah.
Just, there's something about Italian white truffles that's just incredible.
No, they are incredible. In fact, we're going to, in one of the episodes, we're going to go to Piemonte.
Oh, which, how exciting.
Which is where Alba is, which is where all of those truffles come from. So we're going to be there during that time, during truffle season. And I'm very excited about it, but it almost doesn't matter what restaurant you go to, as long as as long as they know how to shave them. That does all that matters. It could be anywhere. You know, it could be like in someone's bathroom. It's like, fine, whatever, it's a truffle.
It's really, and there's something so elegant and special about it, and so earthy, literally earthy about it. It can go on a pizza, it can go on pasta, it doesn't really matter.
Anything.
I absolutely adore it. So I want to wrap this up with you explaining to the audience how to make a Stanley Tucci martini, because we all want to go have one right now.
Okay. Here's what you do. This is in the book. So I learned this from a bartender who was an Italian bartender on the island of Mallorca. So basically, you're going to take a good, nice dry vermouth, and you're going to fill your shaker with ice. Fill it, really fill it. Throw in a shot of vermouth, half a shot of vermouth, and give that a good stir. Let it sit. Give it a good stir. Let it sit. Let the ice get infused with it. Then dump out the vermouth. Then throw in your vodka or your gin, whichever you prefer. And let it sit, give it a stir, let it sit, give it a stir, don't shake it.
No shaking.
And then stirring, and then you have to let it sit a little bit too, and then strain it into a glass. That's it, like a coupe or a martini glass or a Nicanora glass, and then a twist of lemon or an olive, your preference, and that's it. Use good quality booze and good ice, clear ice if you can find it.
That's as simple as it gets, and it just sounds so glamorous and delicious. I think everybody's going to want to make them. And so can we close with your favorite Dorothy Parker quote about martinis? Do you remember?
This is one version of it, yes, which is I like a martini, two at the most, three I'm under the table, or I'm under the host.
That's just wonderful. Stanley, thank you so much. I've had such a good time talking to you. Next time I want to be in the same place
and
we can cook together.
Yeah, I really, really, really would love that.
And I would love to.
Thank you enough. It's a great honor for me to have you do this. I really appreciate it.
It's a great honor to be asked to do it. And I love your book and everybody's just going to adore it.
Oh, I hope so. Thank you.
Thank you, Stanley. Thanks everybody for joining us.
Thank you all.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Hello, I'm Lauren Rosenberg, a program curator at Smithsonian Associates. I want to thank you, Stanley and Ina, for being part of this special collaboration between Smithsonian Associates and Scripps Presents. It's been wonderful to hear from both of you, and I know that you've made this a memorable evening for everybody watching. One more reminder before we say goodnight, your copies of Stanley's book, Taste, will be shipped out shortly. I know you are all eager to read this book, especially after tonight's program, but please be patient and know that the books are on their way. If you enjoyed tonight's program, please consider becoming a Smithsonian member or making a donation to support educational programs like this. And remember to check out our upcoming streaming programs at smithsonianassociates.org. And please let your friends know about our programs and your experience here. So thank you so much. Have a great evening.
Bye, everybody.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you, Stanley.
Thanks, Anna. Thanks.